Today, I'm going to be sharing with you my top 5 tips to have your best December ever and not lose your mind. Okay, so my first tip that I want to share with you, number one, is to set vision and boundaries for the month. So I want you to recognize that this is, you can set a different rhythm for the month of December, so you can have different goals and almost a different vision for what you want your, and if you have a family, your family's life to look like for the month of December. So I want to encourage you to give yourself permission to have a different rhythm, a different vision for what you want out of the month of December. I also want to encourage you to be proactive and not reactive to how you walk through the month of December. Okay, so I want to encourage you to think about, how do you want to feel on January 1st? So you can refer back to on my podcast, the trailer episode, the very first episode, I teach an exercise 5 years in 5 minutes. But I want to encourage you to basically like take a minute or two to think about on January 1st or maybe January 6th, that's when my kids return back to school in January, how do you want to feel about the month of December and the holiday season? I also want to encourage you to be aware that there can be heightened levels of depression during the month of December. So just be aware of that if you're kind of prone to that, or, you know, whatever, factor that in. In January, do you want to feel depressed, or do you want to be rested, grateful, have like beautiful memories? How do you want to feel? And then I also want you to think about, for the month of December, when you're making this vision of what you want for December, what is going to be best for you and your family? And I also want to encourage you, if you have a family, how can you use this holiday season to transfer some of your family values to your children? What memories do you want to have created? What traditions do you want to start, continue, or end? What relationship building things do you want to do during this month? Maybe doing puzzles or games or sportings or outings or watching movies, whatever you feel that brings your family together. What do you want to do? I also want to encourage you to release self-imposed, possibly unhealthy expectations. You know, I just want to let you know, you are not your mom. You are not your dad. You don't have to do things exactly how they did them. You are also not Wonder Woman or Superman. So I just want to encourage you to just release those expectations of maybe what you think December should be or what you should be doing, and figure out what you actually, according to your personal values, should be doing and want to be doing. Okay. And then I also encourage you to talk with your partner and talk with your kids what they want out of the month of December. If you do family meetings, you can look back. I have a Facebook video and a podcast episode about how to do family meetings. This is a great time to talk about during the weekly schedule or monthly schedule or opportunities section. What does your partner and your kids want out of the month of December? And then I encourage you to clearly and kindly communicate your boundaries to others, especially around the area if you're going to travel or not. Now, if you decide that it's best for you not to travel, the earlier you can communicate that to family or loved ones, the better, obviously. But I just want to encourage you, to clearly communicate your boundaries, clearly say no. And I encourage you to join my 7-day challenge. One of the days I talk about the brain science of how to deliver a positive no. It's super powerful. So clearly communicate your boundaries, especially around traveling. And and that's it. So that's that. Oh, and the last thing I want to say under setting vision and boundaries for the month is to encourage you that you are not doing anyone, including yourself, a favor by being a martyr. A lot of women, a lot of mothers have this like martyr syndrome or martyr complex, something like that, where they feel like they have to do it all. And this is kind of related to these unhealthy expectations. Like, you do not need to do it all. I want to encourage you to figure out the things that you want and need to be doing and let the rest go. Okay? So that's the first point, is to set vision and boundaries for the month. Isn't that awesome? Okay, so the second thing is outsourcing and delegating. And again, I'm going to talk about this martyr syndrome. Like, you do not need to be doing everything. And especially if you're feeling resentful about it, then I want to encourage you to think about a way to rearrange your life. Okay. So you are not a martyr. Please, please take that hat off, take that label off. Okay. I want to, so I am like the queen of, if you know me personally, I'm the queen of outsourcing and delegating. I believe it is such an important tool to learn how to utilize in your life, to live a brilliant life. And I know that in the month of December, finances can be tight, and a lot of people listening to this are moms and finances are tight. I want to encourage you with the idea that, like I said in the first point, you can create a different rhythm for the month of December, to consider outsourcing some things possibly just for the month of December. Maybe your family budget can't handle at this point outsourcing some of these things for the entire year, but maybe just outsource it for the month of December. So some things, some ideas to think about would be grocery delivery, cleaners, like household cleaners, hiring a personal assistant who can run errands for you or come into your house, or a virtual assistant. I started my first virtual assistant. I got through Zirtual, a virtual assistant. You, for Christmas cards, we've been doing this for years. We use Card Store. This isn't a plug for Card Store, but there are Christmas card companies that will keep your address book year to year, and then you just create the card online and they actually mail it for you. Okay, so it's a tiny bit less personal, but I still think it's super awesome. But they do all the licking of the envelopes, the writing of the addresses, the stamping, and the mailing. So I think it is totally worth it, and it's really like not that much more expensive at all. It saves so much time. You could outsource gift wrapping either to your partner or to your kids, or I have also hired like teenagers in our neighborhood to either come and be a mother's helper, just watch and play with my kids while I get some stuff done, or I delegate some of these tasks to them. Stuff like when I was mailing my Christmas cards, you know, addressing the Christmas cards, or wrapping presents, that type of thing. I also want to let you know that USPS, the United States Postal Service, will ship you for free boxes, so then you can ship stuff from your house, and then you can just schedule packages to be picked up from your house. So they'll ship you those shipping boxes for free, and I just have like a bunch of boxes on hand, so whenever I need to ship a package, I have a box right at the house. I have multiple different sizes, and then you just have to schedule the pickup, I don't know, 24 or 48 hours in advance. So I never go to the post office. I mean, guys, I like never go anywhere. I never go into any stores. The last idea I had for you for delegating, possibly just for the month of December, is catering your holiday food. So I remember years ago, one of my family members, not like an immediate family member, they like their parents never cooked, and this person never cooked. And when we got together, I was like pretty new in the family. When we got together for a family Thanksgiving or Christmas dinner, this person had like catered the whole meal from, I don't even remember where, maybe Boston Market or something. And it was like mind blown. That idea had never even occurred to me, because my mom always cooked everything from scratch, and it was great. But I have, over the last few years, I think since I had our third kid, definitely since I had our fourth kid, I have not cooked a turkey. I haven't cooked any holiday food. My family knows I'm happy to bring stuff, but it is going to be catered from someplace, especially if we're hosting the family at our house, the meal at our house. You can cater from like Boston Market, Costco, Wegmans, a local grocery store. Some of these places you need to order it a kind of in advance, because they like the stuff gets taken up fast. But if you're listening to this, hopefully in early December, you can still do that. It saves so much time and energy and stress, and it's totally worth it. Okay, so that's the second. So the first tip is to set vision and boundaries for the month of December. Second tip is outsourcing, delegating, possibly just for the month of December. My third tip is micro planning and scheduling. If you guys know me, you know I'm a big micro planning. That is what I teach, is micro planning. So specific to the month, looking at micro planning and scheduling just at a month at a glance, especially this specific month in the year, I want to encourage you to, here at the beginning of the month, list all the activities that you want to do, and then invite input from your partner or your kids and or your kids. And then look at that list and start, first of all, then take a step back and recognize that we all probably struggle a little bit or a lot with FOMO, fear of missing out, and the importance and value of having margin in your schedule. I struggle with this a lot. Okay, so then look at that list, having input, what is important to your partner that you really do or they don't really care about doing, and your kids, and then start scheduling it into the month. Schedule those things that you want to do, whether it be movies or going to like some drive-through light show, or you know, making sugar cookies. Like, schedule that into your calendar at a month at a glance, and then make sure that you have margin. Okay, and then the next tip on that is be willing to cancel things. So if things just start feeling too tight, if somebody gets sick, if just something unexpected happens, be willing to cancel. It is okay. You are responsible for keeping yourself healthy, keeping your kids healthy. If you guys are going at such a pace that you're getting sick, or you're like just getting real like stressed out with your kids or your partner or whatever, then just cancel stuff, you know? And again, I encourage you to register for my challenge. I talk about how to say no positively. So be willing to cancel, plan the month. And then I really want to encourage you, if you can at all do this, I will try to make an episode about meal planning, but meal plan your weeks a week at a time. I think this is really critical, and I encourage you to maybe like set the bar low on those meals. Even if you're meal planning and a meal for the week is cereal, like it's just is so helpful to one day in the week plan your meals. I usually do it Friday because my grocery delivery order is due Friday, and then the groceries get delivered on Saturday. So if you can do the meal planning, I promise you that's going to really help your overall month if you can plan your meals each week. Okay, so that's the third tip, micro planning / scheduling. The fourth thing I want to talk about is how to handle gifts with ease. Okay, so I'm just going to tell you a bunch of different things that I do surrounding the area of gift giving. The first thing I do is I keep lists in my phone year round. I use the Evernote app, and I have one list of a wish list for each of my kids. So whenever they say they want something, I just write it down. And often, and they know this, and this also helps them, like if I don't buy something for them, they know that I've written it down and I can communicate it to other people that want to buy them gifts. And then I keep a list of gifts that I've bought for people throughout the years, because I often don't necessarily remember. I'll often try to write down how much I paid for that item, just so we have a gifts budget so I can see where we are in that budget. Okay, regarding giving gifts to your kids, I go to two major consignment shops a year, consignment sales a year. They're like, in our area, there's some really big church consignment sales. So I go to this one at a church. It's in September and March, and I will buy gifts for my kids. I'll buy used gifts for my kids if I see something that they would really want. And then I will also buy gifts for like other people, other family members, like nieces or nephews, and then we have just a gift bin for like, you know, other people's birthday presents. And for that stuff, I'll buy new gifts that are at the consignment sale. Okay. But for your specific kids, I encourage you, if it's not too late, to set the bar low and only get them, say, three to five gifts from you, the parents. Another thing I do is in years past, I've done this. Sometimes this is helpful in some families, sometimes it's not, but I'll create a universal wish list on Amazon, an Amazon universal wish list. And what that means is you can put gifts on there from Amazon, but you can also put gifts on there from other websites as well. So if you have an excess of gifts, if your kids receive an excess of gifts on Christmas or other holidays, really, you can sort of like siphon away some of those presents, and then you can re-gift them to other children throughout the year. Like we don't have a family that gives like loads and loads of excessive amounts of gifts. But if you're in that situation, I encourage you, you can do that. And you can even talk to your kids about that when they get to be the appropriate age, when they start remembering that they got this gift. And hey there. So you can re-gift gifts if they get an excess. Another thing, if they have a lot of gifts, even if they don't have a lot of gifts, we will often do this. You can put most of the gifts away somewhere. And then I know one woman, Stephanie Gass, who I interviewed on my podcast earlier, she has in their laundry room like a gift or a toy shelf. And each week the kids can pull one toy off the shelf. So you can do that. We have the stuff in the attic and you can bring down a gift each week. Or sometimes I will wait until spring break and summer break and then I'll bring out some of these new and novel toys. I encourage you definitely to rotate your toys. That's a very Montessori principle. I mean, really, like, preschoolers only need 6 to 12 toys out at a time. So rotate your toys when you bring out the new toys, put away the old toys. And before a major holiday or birthday, use this as an excuse to purge toys. Say, we need to make room for the stuff that Santa and Grandma and Grandpa and Mom and Dad are going to give you. So let's go through and give away some of this stuff to, you know, people in need or loved ones, or just throw it in the trash, whatever. But just use it as an excuse to clean out. If you do struggle with getting too many things as gifts, ask your loved ones to give you experiences instead and give them ideas, maybe like even send them links. So some ideas would be like art supplies, a movie night, tickets to a museum, a gift card to a trampoline gym, swimming lessons, bumper cars, a backyard campout, those types of things. So really funding family experiences versus just toys, which often just don't get used. Or you can ask yourself when you're making a toy purchase. So this comes from a book called Raising Children in the Primary Years. How quickly will they get bored with this toy? Can my child use this toy with others? And how long will this toy last? I encourage you to try to invest in toys that are going to last. And then giving, as far as gifts for others, I buy virtually everything online. So I will often, if I don't know what to buy a person, but I want to buy them something, I'll just go onto Amazon and I'll search, like for example, my dad, he's really hard to shop for, but he loves mooses. So long story short, so I will just go on Amazon and I'll search moose and all this super cool stuff will come up and I'll just order stuff. Boom, done. There you go. And this really avoids wasting time waiting in lines, like just waiting in lines. I hate wasting time waiting in lines. So don't wait till the very last minute because, you know, shipments take a little while to get in. Okay, so that's everything I got for you for gifts. Isn't that great? And then the last thing I wanted to talk about, my fifth tip for, you know, thriving in the month of December is decorations. Okay, so one thing that we started doing years ago, almost by default, this was not initially a strategy, but is to invite a friend or two or a couple or that don't have kids over to help you decorate your house for Christmas. Especially when you do have kids, this is a win-win for both situations because like people who don't have kids, the holidays, the December holidays are so fun with kids. It's so much more magical. So I have found it's a huge blessing to invite friends over to join us when we're decorating the house for Christmas because they just get to experience through the eyes of a child and it's just beautiful. But it's also a huge blessing to me because when I am possibly like upstairs nursing a baby or trying to like wrangle one kid or, you know, like things are so crazy, it just takes so long and it's so helpful to have another set of adult hands or two that, you know, appreciate being around your kids and, you know, love your family and they're just there to actually be helpful. So I encourage you, if you have kids, to invite people that don't have kids over to help and it's a win-win. And then we usually just serve like a big frozen lasagna for dinner. You know, I don't add to the chaos of that day by trying to make a huge meal. I used to do that and then I've learned don't do that. Okay, As far as decorations go, I want to encourage you to simplify, especially if you have young children. Like, if this goes back to the vision of what you want for the month of December, but it came for me when I started evaluating this, I realized I wanted some Christmas decorations, but I didn't want to spend hours and hours putting up all these decorations and taking them down and storing them and sorting through them and blah, blah, blah. Like, that just wasn't actually that important to me. So we have really slimmed down the amount of Christmas decorations that we've done. I also want to encourage you, this is for really all holiday decorations, some what I consider big bang for your buck decorations would be vinyl tablecloths. We have a vinyl tablecloth for almost every season. And it's great because it's super easy and it's like to, it doesn't take a lot of space to store. It's easy to switch in and out. And then like your family sees it every day during your meal times. We also, for a few seasons, we have cloth napkins that are seasonal. And and then my last tip around decorations is I encourage you to simplify your decorations, figure out what's really, really important to you, and the rest, just get rid of it. But I also want to encourage you, especially in the month of December, to think about how you can transfer your family values during this holiday month. So this kind of goes back to that point, that tip number one. But for my family, for Hunter and I, we're very strong Christians. And so it's important to us that our children know that the point of Christmas is because Jesus Christ, our Savior, was born, right? You know, and like all the other stuff is super, super awesome. But the point of Christmas for us, and which the value we want to transfer to our kids when they're adults, is that it's all about our Savior's birth, like legit, that's what it's about. So some of our decorations that I've chosen to keep were intentional around, like we have a nativity scene, and it's intentional around having that nativity scene so our kids see that. We also have this super cool, I meant to show it here on this video, but I'll try to put a link in the comments. We have this super cool wooden magnetic advent calendar that I think is really neat. It was pretty expensive, about $50, but it's going to last talk about investing in something that's going to last a lifetime. I think my grandkids will be able to use it. It doesn't involve candy if your kids have allergies, and I think it really depicts, you know, the nativity scene really well. So just thinking about the decorations that you have, we also have a really great family devotional, Advent devotional that we do every night for the month of December. I'll also try to put the link in the comments here. So transferring your family values through decorations. Okay, so just to kind of recap here, 5 tips to thrive in the month of December without losing your mind. Set the vision and boundaries for the month. Recognize that you can create a different vision and a different rhythm for the month of December. The second tip is outsourcing and delegating. And consider outsourcing and delegating things just for this month that you can't afford to delegate the year round, but doing just for this month. The third tip is micro planning and scheduling, and really scheduling out your priorities for the entire month and keeping in margin. The fourth tip we talked about was gifts, how to keep track of gifts, tips for giving gifts to others and to your kids. The fifth tip is decorations and simplifying with your decorations. So guys, I really hope that helped.